My name is Matt Burkhold, and I'll be your host this evening for this fine event in memorial of Grace Lee Boggs. Grace was close to me and played a key role in my development, and we came together, several of us, the organizing committee that you see at the end of the program. Can y'all hear me? Okay. Barely? Can y'all hear me better without the mic?
Thank you, Joyce.
Ain't nothing like being around family.
Where was I?
Oh yeah, we brought this together. Several of us who had personal relationships with Grace and or had read the works of Grace and Jimmy, and they meant a great deal to us. And one of the things that we wanted to do was, was create a memorial where we could really talk about the ideas of Jimmy and Grace and what it was like to work with Grace beyond the image of Grace that's become very popular over the last few years. So we thank all of you for coming out and for sharing in the legacy of Grace Lee Boggs. There are a few things I want to say, and then I'm going to introduce my good brother Richard, Robert. My good brother Robert, I've caught them both all night. Tonight, November 10th, in 1963, Malcolm X, who was murdered, assassinated on these very premises, gave a speech called The Message to the Grassroots. And he gave that speech in Detroit at a conference that was in part organized by Grace Lee Boggs. And that just feels very significant. I'm not going to pretend to speak to the significance of it, but it feels very significant. And I want to extend a special thanks to the Shabazz, to the Malcolm X and Dr. Betty Shabazz Center for hosting us on this night, on this anniversary of that significant date in the history of revolutionary struggle in this country. And so to tell you a little bit about the Malcolm X and Dr. Betty Shabazz Center, I'll give you Robert.
My name is Robert, and I am the on-site director and also the supervisor of maintenance of the Shabazz Center. Dr. Betty Shabazz Center. This is a great center. It's a great venue. It's a great venue. If you were to do anything here,
right,
we rent this place out. And it's an establishment that's underserved. People don't know about this place here. And we need to understand that.
Malcolm X was a great man. He was a terrific man. See, a lot of people thought that he was a militant, thought that he was a bum, thought that he was a pimp. They thought a lot of things about Malcolm. But Malcolm found out in his later years that some of the things that was taught to him by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad were not true. And when he found that out, that's what sealed his death. You know, a lot of things sealed his death. I don't know what y'all know about what sealed his death, but when he said the chickens coming home, the roost, that was one. And when he exposed the Honorable Elijah Muhammad with the teenage girls having a pressure, that was two. And they just couldn't have him because he was talking about the world of human rights instead of just one particular group. You know, so he did a vast number of things. But this center is open in his behalf. And if you walk down this mural will tell you everything about his life. So we hope that you enjoy. We welcome you once, we welcome you twice, we welcome you three times.
Thank you very much, Robert. So we're going to start the program with Dr. Amaka Okwuchukwu, who was a woman who was given several assignments by Grace And we'd like to think that this last one is to hit us with an edited version of Grace's obituary.
Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. Hello, hello, hello. Okay. My name is Amaka Okachukwu, and I will be reading the obituary for you today so you can know more about Grace's life. This was written by Stephen Ward, who is a historian at the University of Michigan and also a member of the Boggs Center board. And he has a dual biography of Grace and Jimmy that is coming out in spring. Part one. There are two parts. So part one is coming out in the spring, so definitely look out for that. Grace Lee Boggs was a philosopher and revolutionary who devoted her long and full life to making an American Revolution. As a comrade to many, as well as a daughter, sister, aunt, and stepmother, Grace directly touched hundreds of lives and influenced many more. She believed deeply in the power of ideas, and throughout her 75 years of activism, theorizing, writing, and organizing, she consistently challenged herself and others to accept the task of developing ideas which she saw as essential for revolutionary change. She was born Grace Chin Lee on June 27, 1915, in Providence, Rhode Island. Her parents had immigrated to the United States from the Guangdong province, China. When Grace was 8 years old, her family moved to Queens, New York, where she grew up with six siblings. Grace's father opened and operated Chinese restaurants in several cities, and Grace spent much of her childhood at his two restaurants in Times Square, Chin Lee's and Chin's. Books and reading played a central role in Grace's childhood. She was a talented student, graduating from high school at the age of 15 and winning a scholarship to attend Barnard College. Attending college in the midst of the Depression, she decided to major in philosophy and began to ask questions about the world and her place in it. Grace graduated from Barnard in 1935 and then went to graduate school at Bryn Mawr College, where she encountered philosophical texts and ideas that profoundly influenced her thinking. The most important of these was the German philosopher Hegel, whose ideas formed the foundation of Grace's concept of dialectical thinking that she made central to her intellectual and political work for the rest of her life. Grace completed her formal studies in 1940, earning a PhD in philosophy at the age of 25. Just a few months after earning her degree, Grace moved to Chicago, where she encountered the Black freedom struggle and radical politics, which together solidified her commitment to theorizing and working toward revolutionary change. Grace credited the March on Washington movement, led by A. Philip Randolph, with showing her the power of Black protest and sparking her commitment to the Black struggle. She simultaneously immersed herself in Marxism and radical politics by joining a grouping within the Workers' Party, and later the Socialist Workers' Party, known as the Johnson Forest Tendency, led by C.L.R. James and Raya Denevskaya. Grace moved back to New York, where the group was centered, and emerged as its third leader. Through the rest of the 1940s, she played a primary role in the group's theoretical discussions and writing on the Hegelian dialectic, the historical development of the Black struggle, philosophical and political analyses of working class life, and the application of Marxism to mid-20th century United States. Among her most impressive contributions, Grace discovered and translated from the original German portions of Marx's economic and philosophic manuscripts of 1844, the first time that this classic Marxist text appeared in English. In 1953, Grace moved back to Detroit, moved to Detroit for the first time, where she would live the rest of her life. Shortly after arriving in the city, she developed a courtship with auto worker, labor organizer, and radical activist James Boggs. They had met the previous year as comrades in the same political organization, and now working closely together, publishing the group's newspaper correspondence, they built a relationship based upon their mutual attraction and shared commitment to revolutionary change. Grace and Jimmy married in 1954. Together they organized, wrote, and struggled in dozens of organizations and movements over the course of four decades, building a remarkable partnership as a married couple, political comrades, and intellectual collaborators. By the 1960s, Grace and Jimmy operated within a vibrant network of Black radicals in Detroit and beyond, and they were recognized as important figures in the Black Power movement. Grace was respected in particular for her organizing skills, as well as her theoretical and historical understanding of the Black struggle. While she avoided the spotlight, Grace played a pivotal role in major developments and organizing efforts of this period, such as the Northern Negro Grassroots Leadership Conference in 1963, where Malcolm X delivered his famous message to the grassroots speech, and the Michigan Freedom Now Party in 1964. Grace and Jimmy also conceived and founded groups such as the Organization for Black Power and the Inner City Organizing Committee. Along with her role as organizer and activist, Grace made a significant contribution to the development of the Black Power movement through her theoretical work and writings, such as The City is a Black Man's Land, an essay that Grace and Jimmy co-authored, and The Black Revolution in America, Grace's contribution to the groundbreaking anthology The Black Woman, edited by Tony Cade Bambara. Through their political and intellectual engagement with Black freedom struggle, and particularly their activity during the Black Power movement, Grace and Jimmy's understanding of revolutionary change moved beyond Marxist conceptualizations of class struggle, working class insurgency, and the seizing of state power. The 67 Detroit Rebellion helped them rethink and clarify their concept of revolution. As Grace recalled, the rebellion, quote, forced us to rethink a lot of philosophical questions, leading them to draw a clear distinction between rebellion and revolution. As they moved into this new stage of their activism, Grace and Jimmy put an emphasis on reflection, giving themselves the time and space to carefully consider and learn from past struggles and ideas. They began to periodically travel to Sutton Island, Maine, where they held several days of conversations on a range of political and philosophical questions with their longtime friends and comrades, Freddie and Lyman Payne. The two couples made these conversations an annual practice, some of which were edited and published in the book Conversations in Maine, Exploring Our Nation's Future. Grace and Jimmy put forward the new evolutionary concept of revolution that they developed during the 60s and early 70s in their co-authored book, Revolution and Evolution in the 20th Century, published in 1974. Quote, a revolution is not just for the purpose of correcting past injustices, they wrote. The only justification for a revolution is that it advances the evolution of man and woman. The theoretical and organizing work they did around these ideas, including holding study groups with young Black radicals in Detroit, led Grace and Jimmy to found their next major political organization, the National Organization for an American Revolution, or NOR. Started in 1978, NOR projected a concept of two-sided transformation, political transformation linked to personal transformation, or working to change society and change oneself simultaneously. This concept Grace continued to articulate and develop over the years. With the dissolution of NOR in the mid-1980s, Grace and Jimmy entered yet another stage in their political work. They took on a renewed focus on Detroit and the challenges of post-industrial cities, immersing themselves in community-building efforts and the development of grassroots leadership. These commitments are reflected in the many organizations that Grace and Jimmy founded or participated in during the second half of the 1980s and the early 1990s, including Detroiters for Dignity, Save Our Sons and Daughters, We the People Reclaim Our Streets, and Detroiters United. The effort that is perhaps most reflective of their ideas and legacy from this period is Detroit Summer, an intergenerational multicultural youth program / movement to rebuild, redefine, and re-spirit Detroit from the ground up, co-founded by Grace and Jimmy in 1992. Detroit Summer put into practice a vision of young people as leaders and initiators of community change, and many of its participants have subsequently inspired, influenced, or are directly engaged in contemporary community-based work in urban agriculture, grassroots media, place-based education, and other areas. In July 1993, 1 year after Detroit Summer began, Jimmy died of lung cancer. With the end of their marital, political, and intellectual partnership, Grace again entered a distinctly new phase of her life. 2 years later, comrades of Grace and Jimmy formed the James and Grace Lee Boggs Center to Nurture Community Leadership, of which she was a founding board member. The Boggs Center was Grace's primary political organization for the last two decades of her life. Throughout the 1990s and the first decades of the 21st century, Grace maintained her active role in Detroit grassroots politics, while at the same time receiving greater attention and interest in her ideas nationally. Recognized as both a movement icon and an influential radical thinker, Grace helped to inspire and shape grassroots efforts such as urban agriculture, place-based education, and community production. In 1998, at the age of 83, Grace published her autobiography, Living for Change. For several years after that, she wrote a weekly column under that title for the independent Black Detroit weekly newspaper, The Michigan Citizen. Well into her 90s, Grace continued to attend political meetings, speak to classes and activist gatherings, and hold ongoing conversations with the many people, the longtime comrades, emerging activists, community leaders, artists, youth, who came to see her. She helped to activate existing networks and generate new frameworks for local struggles, including Detroit City of Hope and Detroiters Resisting Emergency Management, contributing to the city's vibrant grassroots political culture and the creation of radical community-based alternatives. She gave dozens of interviews and made media appearances on programs such as Democracy Now!, sharing her evolutionary concept of revolution, one that transforms and empowers people as they struggle to change the world. In 2011, Grace published her last book, written with Scott Kurashige, The Next American Revolution, Sustainable Activism for the 21st Century. In the last years of her life, Grace urged activists to practice visionary organizing, or grassroots political organizing, not focused solely on protesting current injustices, but rather geared toward projecting alternatives and creating new visions for the future. The Next American Revolution provides the historical and theoretical foundation for this type of organizing. The documentary film, American Revolutionary, The Evolution of Grace Lee Boggs, was released in June 2013, the month that Grace turned 98. She participated in screenings of the film in Detroit and other cities, emphasizing that revolutionary change requires us to make time for reflection as well as action. She demonstrated her commitment to this by combining theory with practice over the course of her 75 years of revolutionary thinking and activism. On June 27, 2015, Grace celebrated her 100th birthday. She was unable to attend any of the week-long series of events held in her honor, but she received visitors during the week. Over the next several weeks, Grace continued to have conversations, as her strength and energy allowed, with the close comrades, friends, and caregivers who spent her final days with her at her home, 3061 Field Street, the house where she lived for 53 years. Grace Lee Boggs died in her sleep on October 5th, 2015. She lived 100 years and 100 days. She is survived by the members of the extended Lee and Boggs families and by the thousands of people whose ideas and lives she touched. Grace's legacy will be felt in the changes to our world as that we have yet to imagine. Thank you.
Thank you, Amaka. Every time I hear that phrase, that the purpose of revolution is to advance the evolution of man and womankind, I'm taken back, because the first time I read it was such a vastly different kind of understanding of revolution than I had ever found before. And so that was one of those ideas that always resonated with me. And we're gonna take a few minutes to watch a couple clips of Grace talking about her ideas herself.
First of all, to begin, I have to go back to Seattle in 1999. And the slogan, another world is possible, emerged out of a completely new mentality, when people recognized that essentially those in control are dysfunctional. And that the whole social democracy depends on those who felt in power to give you things, but that period is over. And I think it's really wonderful that the social forum is starting to come to Detroit, because Detroit, which was once the symbol of miracles of industrialization, and then became the symbol of the devastation of industrialization, is now the symbol of a new kind of society, of people who grow their own food, of people who try and help each other to how we be able to think not so much of getting jobs, and as I say, our own fortunes, but how we depend on each other. I mean, it's a long world that we're creating here in Detroit, and we have to. We need to do so because we're better people than anybody else. But when you look out, you always see the bigger bluffs. When all you see is little station, when all you see, do you look at it as a curse, or do you look at it as a possibility? That's how we put it. So, and we here in Detroit have to begin doing that for our own humanity.
That was great to move on to 2010. I want to go back three more years to 2007 when Democracy Now! Juan Gonzalez and I spoke with Grace Lee Boggs and the late poet and activist Amiri Baraka to mark the 40th anniversary of the 1967 rebellions in Detroit and Newark.
Amiri, what has changed in these 40 years in terms of consciousness and in terms of what the country has learned from that period?
Well, actually, in some ways, we've gone full cycle, but up to another level. I mean, we went from the kind of blatant normalization of white supremacy and racism. We then organized ourselves and elected two black mayors. We haven't, none of my children, for instance, have ever grown under white people ruling in Newark. They don't even know what that is, you understand? And so we can be proud of that. But at the same time, after we had our two domestic kind of mayors who compromised relentlessly with corporate power, you understand? Now we've come full circle.
No, that's the question of your being saying that we have challenged and criticized and evaluated black power sufficiently.
I don't know. No, but I've been doing it for us.
I don't know what I do it.
Well, I've been doing it for almost 37 years. I mean, having two black mayors there, Sean James and Ken Gibson, I was probably their most relentless critic all the time. But now we have somebody who doesn't compromise with corporate power, but who represents it. So that's the difference.
Well, do you think it's a question of changing an individual, you know, such as for changing that person
and individual system? You have to get an individual who's willing to actually struggle with the system to change it. As long as you have people who...
I mean, what do we mean by struggling with the system? How do we make
an exception to change it? To make it for the
change? Well, what do we need to understand that we have to create new infrastructures in which we can't do it for the people? It's not out of the... We're not going to do it for the people at the top. We're going to have to leave it for the
whole community. But what I'm saying is that we have became accommodated to being in power. We're not changing.
Yes. But you see, we put so much emphasis on taking over the power structure, and we became prisoners of it.
That's Grace Lee Boggs debating the great poet Amiri Baraka back in 2007 at Democracy Now! In fact, next week, on October 15th, we'll be speaking with Russ Baraka, Amiri Baraka's son, who is now the mayor of Newark. But I want to turn back to Grace Lee Boggs from the last time she appeared in our studio here on Democracy Now! In 2013.
And finally, Grace, talk about getting older.
People need
ignoring people who are very needy. They're very needy. They need to know that a revolution is to advance their humanity, to advance the humanity of the human race. They need to know that a revolution is to create solutions and not to get angry at other people. We need to know that a revolution is not just protest, it's not just anger, it's not just a search for power. It's a search for real problems for how to be a human being. And I think that's what we need about the American Revolution, and that's what we need about this country. Because even though there is a lot of poverty, there's a lot of inequality, there are a lot of physical hardships. I think the most profound hardship of the American people is that they want to change. They want to change themselves, they want to change this world, and they don't know how to do it. And revolution is going to do it, but not a real kind of revolution. So I think in that sense, the reason the people are talking so positively is that the city itself does need to be a very profound meaning. I mean, this country is in such deep trouble spiritually in every human sense. It's not just the finances, it's not just the joblessness, it's
we will now hear from Myrtle Curtis Thompson, who will share with us some of her reflections on working with Grace and Grace's life and her practice of putting growing one's soul at the center of what it means to be a revolutionary.
Thank you for being here, and I first want to acknowledge and acknowledge our ancestors, my ancestors whose shoulders on which I stand, which Grace is now one of. And we just recently lost a revolutionary media person in Detroit, Tangela Harris. And sometimes I think we just talk too much, and as I reflect on Grace's words just then, I really have to reflect on Grace's words. These are my notes. They're all over the place. Because as I met Grace in 2008, and I had the consciousness of a high schooler. I married a man who was co-founder of Feed and Freedom with me, who had been working with me for about 15 years on trying to raise my conscience level. And through him, I met Grace Lee Boggs at one of the Boggs Center meetings. And I had been aware of her only through her Living for Change article, and the picture was not the best picture. It was not. And so when I met her, she's this little tiny Asian lady. She's very old. She was kind, but not frivolous, and super, super curious. I mean, she asked questions, lots of questions. And I'm one of those persons in Detroit who is growing food to feed my family, to sell it at market. It also goes in the neighborhood food pantries. And it's also an introduction to social justice in our area. So for me, I was, because Grace has limited mobility, I was a way to be in the neighborhoods in that urban ag. I learned about Detroit Summer and Grace's founding of Grace and Jimmy's founding of Detroit Summer, and I realized how important my contribution to her was. I don't think she had any idea what her contribution to me was. It was always, what are you reading? What are you writing? Are you writing about that? When you write about something, your voice gets larger. How are you challenging the children? Can you bring the children here? Can we have an event here? I would love to meet them. I had the pleasure of traveling with Grace Lee Boggs to help push the wheelchair or carry the cane or carry the bags or whatever else to be of some assistance. And I remember this one trip to Chicago, and me and Barbara Stokowski, another member of the Boggs board, and Grace, we pulled over on the side of the road, and we had this real simple meal of chicken salad, some crackers and bread, and these wonderful desserts that Grace loved. She loved these fudgy chocolate dessert things. And Grace started asking questions about being a mother. How do you do this, being a mother, and doing this other stuff that you do? And she would contemplate real how different her life might have been had she had her own biological children. And she came up with this term, and so we laugh about it today, and she called Barb and I solutionaries, because we had to figure ways to get things done when things weren't always going the way they should. So making a way out of no way became solutionaries. I can still taste that chicken salad and see that look on Grace's face when she contemplated, how do you do it? As I think about her life, and I'm one of those persons, I'm thinking, Grace sacrificed herself to just be part of practicing. She just gave herself up to the struggle. Grace actually wanted to be in a university teacher, but the chance was denied her. And I thought about a woman who did not become bitter through struggle. She became stronger. And she challenged everybody she came across. So the first thing I have to do is invite everybody to Detroit. If you haven't been, come and see what's happening in Detroit. See how we're making a way out of no way. Are you in a book study group? Have you read American Revolutionary? Have you read TNAR? Are you studying? How are you challenging those in your circle? That's what Grace did for me every day. When Grace, even at the end of her long, purposeful life, and she said it wasn't easy, she still wanted to talk political, transformational, engagement, critically think. It's real. It's not something she put on. It's not nothing she done. And please don't turn her into Santa Claus. Growing your soul is not this warm, fuzzy thing. For me, Grace was live simply so that others can simply live. But it's not just a phrase. It's a thing that you do. It's a challenge. It's a daily challenge. And that's what I remember. That's what I will continue to remember. Like I say, sometimes I think we talk too much. I don't want to talk too much. I want to internalize how I feel right now. I feel honored to be here. I will definitely miss her physical, but I will always have her spiritual. I have my personal notes of being able to sit in a room across from her. And I have to share that I am not one of the people who received a beatdown from Grace Lee Boggs. She had this uncanny knack of knowing who could stand it and who couldn't. And I was too fragile. So at the Boggs Center, she nurtured She nurtured community leadership. She nurtured my leadership. But she also expressed knowing when to step back and when to step up in that position of leadership. I'm eternally grateful, and thank you guys for listening.
While Myrtle was immune to Grace's beatdowns, I certainly was not. I think Grace once denounced me in the middle of a conversation. But she did it with love. Now we're going to hear Michelle Lynn Luce, who is the co-founder of Detroit Asian Youth Project and a landscape architect. There we go. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. I want to thank all of the event organizers for putting this on today, and also thank Matt and Amaka for inviting me to speak with you all. I met Grace about 15 years ago in 2001. At that time, I was a sophomore at the University of Michigan, and I was just coming into my own identity as an Asian American and as a young activist. I was part of a small group of students who organized a panel on popular education, and with the help of Scott Kershier and Emily Lawson, we organized this session with Grace, along with Glenn Monsu and Debbie Way, both of whom are also community activists. Before the larger session, we all met with Grace as a smaller group, and we went around the room and introduced ourselves. When it came to be my turn, she looked at me in the eye, leaned in, and asked, "What were you taught about communists in China?" I didn't even know what I was Chinese. I think at that moment, I muttered something incoherent about Mao Zedong and how he wanted to erase Chinese culture, something completely ignorant of what it was really about. And in that moment, Grace instilled in me this craving and need to connect with a revolutionary tradition of my own community, whether it was abroad or here in the United States. Next slide, please. So after graduating, I had to figure out what I wanted to do. I was particularly inspired and fueled by what Grace said about Dr. King's concept of agape love, that there are three types of love, one being philia, which is the affection between friends, two called eros love, which we know as romantic love, and three, agape love, which is the type of love it takes to build and struggle for the beloved community. So that is what really fueled my decision to move to Detroit. And also, I would often hear Grace quote Jimmy Boggs, quote Jimmy Boggs about loving this country enough to struggle for it. So I moved to Detroit. I fell in love with Detroit. I fell in love with the people, the land, the struggle. I became a Detroit summer volunteer, attended Boggs Center conversations, and even started a study group, which we read books that would be recommended by Grace. Just keep clicking through. So those four books were actually books that Grace recommended me reading last December when I visited her in Detroit. She wanted me to revisit these seminal titles. Next slide, please. So Grace also talking about what it meant to be Asian American in Detroit. I remember once she said that API has had an important role in helping us break the binary of thinking about race in this country and in Detroit. And we explored this through a number of ways. through a symposium on Asian American organizing in Detroit. We looked at the history of the Vincent Chin killing in Detroit, as well as the growing population of Hmong and South Asians that were living in the city. And out of that, we founded the Detroit Asian Youth Project, which in large part was modeled after Detroit Summer, where we believe that young people had to be part of creating the solutions of rebuilding our neighborhoods. When I left Detroit to study landscape architecture and design, Grace continued to dialogue with me over email, and at one point she even gave me a platform through her weekly column to test this idea we had been talking about, which was called community-based manufacturing. And I was, in short, it was about rethinking and redesigning manufacturing so that it was rooted in a place-based strategy that wouldn't strip people of their humanity due to globalization and automation. And it would really aim at recovering the societal value of people that actually made things. I don't remember Grace ever calling herself a designer, but I think that she really did embody a lot of design thinking. Her ability to constantly question what we take for granted, to never stay stuck in old ways of thinking, to push us to reimagine everything, whether it was reimagining what work means, reimagining education, to innovate and explore new possibilities. And one of Grace's most important questions that she leaves us is, what time is it on the clock of the world today? And as a landscape architect, I think about this in the following ways. How do we plan for our cities so that our relationships aren't based off of monetary transactions or exploitation? How can our city building change if we prioritize water? How do we design intergenerational landscapes, and how do we do this in a truly democratic way? Will we as designers and activists and artists have the imagination that is rich enough to be part of creating the next American Revolution? Thank you.
Thank you, Michelle. Those books that you put up there, I was once in Detroit to give a talk somewhere, and Grace asked to see my talk. She read it, and she gave me about four or five books and told me to go home, read them all, and then rewrite the whole talk one time. Because that's just how Grace got down. Next, we're going to hear from a young brother named Kevin Lassan, who is wearing a Malcolm X pin, and I asked him if he wore it just today or he wears it every day. He said he wears it every day, and I said, why? He said, because he feels it like that. So we're going to bring Kevin up here to write a poem that Grace wrote in 1982 for an anti-nuclear weapons demonstration here in New York City. So show you love for Kevin Lassan.
We are the children of Martin and Malcolm, black, brown, red, and white. And so we cannot be silent. And we witness the weapons assembled to blister our souls and incinerate our planet. We are the children of Martin and Malcolm, our ancestors, proud and brave, defy the storms of and power of masters and madmen. We are the children of Martin and Malcolm, and when bombs push the sun from the sky and threaten to fill the air with blood and screams of the dead and dying, we cannot be silent. We are the children of Martin and Malcolm. Our birthright is to be creators of history. Our glory is to struggle. You shall know our names as you know theirs. Sojourner and Douglas, John Brown and Garrison. We are the children of Martin and Malcolm, black, brown, red, and white. Our right, our duty, to shape the world with a new dream. Thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. It is our right, our duty, to shape the world with a new dream. I ask y'all to think about what that means. And while y'all are thinking about that, I'm going to ask our next speaker, Ron Land, who was a comrade of Grace and Jimmy's in the 70s and 80s, to come on up to the stage.
Good evening, everyone. I guess the first thing I'd like to do is state the obvious, and that is that this is truly a great honor for me to be here speaking before you tonight. It seems to me that any time someone wants to play honor and tribute to Grace Lee Boggs, and I can be a part of it, it is truly an honor. Now, I want to thank Matt because I had said, when he first asked me whether or not I wanted to speak, my first response was no. That's what I said to myself. I told Matt, I'll think about it. And the reason I want to think about it is because in my adult life, Grace was truly one of the two people who were most important in my life. And that other person was her husband, James Boggs. And so when he asked me to speak, my first response was that I didn't think I was capable enough to pay the true respect and honor that Grace deserved. And I didn't feel that I could adequately do that. But it reminded me, as I thought about it, I realized the fact that Grace wouldn't have allowed that. That she made each and every one who came in contact with her, that you have to challenge yourself. You have to take the next step, that you just can't take the easy way out. And she had a remarkable, very remarkable way of making you think, after she spoke, that you can do just about anything. And so I really couldn't say no, because I could feel Grace looking at me and getting ready to give me a beat down, as folks have mentioned. Now, even though I still don't think I can adequately do that, I'm going to make an attempt. Now, before I do, now I've known Grace and Jimmy Boggs for over 40 years. And one of the reasons I know them is that a good friend of mine who accompanied me here tonight, Robert Brooks, he was the person who introduced me to James and Jimmy, and James and Grace. And he was just telling me that back in the 70s, him and another comrade of ours would drive once a month from New York to Detroit to talk with Jimmy and Grace. So he has a much longer history than even I have with Jimmy and Grace. So she told us how to do what we can do, and I want to thank publicly Robert for introducing me to Jimmy and Grace. Now I want to tell you a little about, I was in NOR, the National Organization for American Revolution. Another one of our comrades, Jeff Grabowski, is here. I hadn't seen Jeff in many, many years. And it's good to see him again and his wife, Karen. So I've known them for a very long time. And we had chapters that were formed in all the different, six or seven different cities in the United States. And here in New York, it was called the New World Developers. And this was the forerunner of what I would call chapters throughout various cities, who eventually became NOR, the National Organization for American Revolution. And in these different chapters, we would organize, we'd sell literature, we'd write literature. One of my favorites was the one that's entitled Crime Among Our People. And one of the very simple things it said was, if you don't like crime in your community, then why are you buying hot goods? Very simple. If you buy hot goods, you're subsidizing crime. So if you don't want it, don't buy hot goods. That little four-page thing was tremendous here in New York City, very effective. Another one of the pamphlets we distributed and sold to raise money to support our the work that we were doing was called Change Yourself to Change the World. Again, a very simple title. If you're going to think about changing the world, or being a revolutionary, or following in James and Grace's footsteps, then change yourself first. Look in the mirror and check your ego at the door. And then one other one I want to mention is the awesome responsibility of revolutionary leadership. Grace and Jimmy lived that. It wasn't a theory for them to talk about revolution. They lived it in their actions each and every day. And so as we sold these pamphlets to make money to support our activities, inside of NOR was a little different. We had endless meetings. We were always meeting, sometimes 3 or 4 times a week, sometimes in a different city in another part of the country, attending conventions. And this is where I learned so much about being a revolutionary, learned so much from James and Grace. And by the way, I oftentimes say Jimmy and Grace, or Grace and Jimmy, sometimes I identify them differently, because they were two distinct personalities, as different as night and day, and yet they were totally united in their commitment to revolutionary struggle. So sometimes I talk about the two of them, but I only mean one, and vice versa. So at a lot of these meetings, Jimmy and Grace oftentimes disagreed with each other. One of them would speak, and I'd sit there and nod my head, hey, that's right, I support that, that's true. And then the next one would speak, totally different, criticizing what the previous one of them said, whether Jimmy was first or Grace was next, challenging each other. That's what they did. And so for me, it was kind of difficult at first, particularly since I'm thinking sometimes the meetings were in their house, I'm thinking they're criticizing each other, they're disagreeing, and they got to go to bed tonight. I said, and I sort of took that personally. I figured maybe in my marriage, I could disagree with my wife, tell her that she was wrong, and see how it worked at home. Well, many, many years later, and several wives later, I still haven't gotten it down pat. I'm working on it. Grace and Jimmy set examples to change your personal life, your political life, your social life. I'm gonna get this working yet here. Now, as a couple of other speakers already mentioned, and as the slideshow have shown, Grace did just about everything. She was an intellectual, she was a foot soldier, she attended the marches, the protests, the demonstrations, she helped organize them, she was a theoretician, she was a philosopher, she did all. And it was very, very challenging for anyone in her presence to live up to, because as people have already mentioned, she didn't let you slip slide. She challenged you to live up to what she herself was doing. Now, in thinking about Grace, I reflected on when you talk about weaknesses, one of my own personal weaknesses is I don't have a very good memory for detail. I don't, and I recognize that. But I'm sort of like rescued by something Maya Angelou said. She said, you don't oftentimes remember what people said, but you remember how they made you feel. And that's what it was being around Jimmy and Grace for me. I couldn't tell you what Grace said at a particular date and time. I couldn't tell you what she wrote. But I can tell you how she made me feel. She emboldened me. She empowered me. She challenged me to be creative, to not take anything for granted, that struggle was important and necessary. And I'm sure Grace wrote all these things someplace and said these things sometime or whatever. But I know that's what she meant to me. I have plenty of notes here, but I'm not going to spend the whole time on them. Now, I spoke earlier about how the fact that a lot of the meetings, they would go back and forth with each other. It was almost like watching your two favorite tennis players playing a tennis match and back and forth, no one giving or taking. They're staying up there, the ball is going back and forth on net, trying to figure out which one of them you agree with, who was going to win this battle. The reality was, it often seemed that they were struggling with each other, but in reality, they were challenging everybody else in the room to recognize that you have to struggle. You have to criticize. Doesn't matter whether you love the person or not. You have a revolutionary responsibility to challenge everything that is said and put forth. And they didn't really care about what you thought. They cared more about how you thought. And that leads me to the most important thing I think I learned from James and Grace, and that is that the concept of dialectics. It teaches us how to think. It recognizes when James and Grace are not here or not around, that we have the tools to analyze not only our personal lives, not only our social lives, but certainly our political lives, that we know how to think. And dialectics simply says growth and development and truth come out of struggle and criticism. Criticisms of your loved ones as well as criticisms of yourself. Dialectics tells us that there's a unity in opposites, that the only reason that there's light is because there's darkness. The only reason that it's high is because there's low. Only reason that there's weakness is because there's strength. That we have these tools to analyze the world. And so, most of all, it teaches us that we should not be afraid of criticism, but rather we should welcome criticism. When we are criticized, we learn about our weaknesses. How are we going to get strong if we don't learn about our weaknesses? So dialectics is a way of looking at the world so we can better analyze it and understand it and therefore change it. So in conclusion, I often think about what my life would be like if I had not met Grace and James Boggs. That's a terrible thought, I think, for me anyway, because they meant so much to me, as I said earlier, the two most important people in my adult life. So the clock and the calendar tells us that Grace lived to be 100 years of age. But in terms of what she accomplished in those 100 years, makes her at least 200 years of age. And of those of us who are in this community and other places in the world who Grace touched, Our responsibility is to make her life and legacy another 200 years. So I thank all of you. I thank Matt and the other organizers for allowing me to think and speak to you today. Thank you.
I once heard Grace describe dialectical thinking by simply saying that once you think you've got an answer, that's when your problems begin. You got to take time to examine the implications of that position and that answer and what is going to come out of it. Next, we will have Rosanna Foster, who has the unique distinction of being one of the few women who introduced Grace to the women's movement. And the women's movement, and as always, filled with wonderful things to say. So she's gonna share something for us.
Several of us who had been working together in one of the groups pulled together about two cases of books, brought them over, and with a week, she had pretty much understood intellectually what it was about. But that, of course, is never enough. So I want to say a little bit about myself in relationship to Jimmy and Grace, how I met them, how they influenced my life, and most importantly, what I learned in terms of what it means to be, what it means to change yourself. I was an attorney in the city of Detroit. I worked with the National Lawyers Guild. The National Lawyers Guild considered itself the legal arm of the movement for social change. I was involved in what would be called traditional left politics, and then moved on, like many of us, into new left politics. And one of the defining characteristics was what was considered the fundamental contradiction. Ron spoke about the dialectics. What I want to say is the fundamental contradiction, and by the way, how many of you have heard that term? The fundamental contradiction is supposed to be the kingpin on which all else rests. And if you can discern that, if you can discover it, you're on your way to possibly making the revolution. So classical Marxist theory considered the kingpin, the fundamental contradiction between labor and capital. Grace and Jimmy challenged that. And when I was in Detroit practicing law, involved in the legal community and also other political communities, they thought that Jimmy and Grace were just a little bit out there. Maybe beginning to border on the human potential movement, because they considered the contradiction, fundamental contradiction, something very, very different. Now I'm gonna back up a little bit. There was something I wanted to say, how I met them and how I heard about what they considered the fundamental contradiction. I'm sure most of you know, it's not a mystery, but I'm gonna act as if you don't know. I had been sick for about a year with an illness that really was very intense. When I got out of the hospital, I felt very, very lost, and I could not go back to politics as usual. Somehow, the politics, the groups, communities I were in felt deficient. I felt we were doing good work. However, our ideal did not meet the real in the way we were with one another. The way we acted with one another left a lot to be desired. So I felt lost, didn't know what to do, and then someone I knew said, hey, why don't you go meet Jimmy and Grace Boggs? I didn't know who they were. I called them up, they invited me over, and I went to their home on Field Street. We met on the porch on a summer day, and they were extraordinary in the way they spoke with me, took me in, understood where I had been, and then began to talk about change and the fundamental contradiction. He said the fundamental contradiction was not between labor and capital. It was not about race, because there began to be a hierarchy of what the fundamental contradiction was in the 60s, the 70s. Labor and capital, race, sex, gender. He said it's none of these things. The fundamental contradiction, the major problem is this, that we are an economically and technologically overdeveloped people, country. And what we need to be is socially, politically developed. We are overdeveloped in one area and underdeveloped in the other. And that this, understanding of this, was the source of being able to move forward and begin a revolutionary struggle. After a boy, they added, just the way Grace asked, bring me some books of the women's movement, bring us some books on what's happening in the spiritual movement. So they added psychologically, spiritually, economically, and politically underdeveloped. This was very significant to me because it hearkened to the my experience and what happened to me when I was in the hospital. Because when I came out, I felt totally lost. So this really spoke to me. I knew that there was something very profound here. So I said I was interested. I would like to work with them. 2 weeks later, two people show up in my office. They're going to interview me to see if I was ready to join the organization. It was quite an interesting interview. It was decided that I'd join, but not the major organization, because Grace and Jimmy at that time had an organization called the Advocates, which was only for Black people, because they wanted to develop Black leadership. What we could do was start a white organization, educate ourselves so that one day we can merge with the other organization and create a Organization for American Revolution, where white people would not just automatically take over. So I met for 3 years in a basement, plotting a revolution, reading doing study groups around evolution and revolution in the 20th century. We didn't succeed, not then. However, what was critical and what we were developing was an understanding of another level of what the fundamental contradiction is. A step above and beyond economically and technologically overdeveloped, emotionally, politically, psychologically underdeveloped. And that came with change yourself to change the world. Evolve. Change yourself to change the world. Evolve. And this was like splitting the atom. This was very critical. What it was asking us to do was to go inside and become the change we wanted to be. Wonderful. How do you do that? What do you do? I need to look at my notes, I forgot. How do you do that? This goes to how you build an organization. How do you build a new organization that practices what it preaches, models what it needs to be, which is what they're trying to do in Detroit. Create a society in the present instead of waiting for the revolution. Bring the revolution into your everyday existence. How do we become the change? And our understanding was you begin by telling the truth. What truth? Whose truth? your own truth. You start is you have to be willing to see yourself and share that with each other in the context of community. Ron talked about criticism. I remember we had big meetings about criticism, self-criticism, modeled after what we thought was going on in China. However, it was not what was going on in China. It's not about criticism, self-criticism with a whip. It's about looking at oneself and each other through love and understanding, and knowing that only by willing to meet each other at the point where there's friction, that friction point, and looking at it, understanding where it comes from, we can then build a higher level of understanding. So fundamentally, the fundamental contradiction is the split that we have with one another, the I-thou split, where we don't see each other as equal to, where we don't see each other basically as one. In order to see each other as one, the evolutionary step is to see each other as one. And in doing that, we are then capable of connecting with ourselves, with our deeper selves and each other. Because if we don't connect with our own deeper self, we can never connect with each other. So this is what I got from, this is what I learned from being with Grace, from arguing with Grace. As you can see, she was not the easiest person to, just wasn't the easiest person. But it was an incredible experience. I also want to add up quickly, and then I will finish, is that after living in Detroit, I moved to California. I felt that I had lived in Detroit, the home of the proletariat, was round, and I was going to go out to California to find out what they were about. And the interesting thing was that Grace in Detroit, Grace and Jimmy, were doing a lot of similar explorations, but grounded in reality and in the real. Whereas in California, a lot was going on that was important, but it felt somewhat ethereal. And one of the ethereal things that I learned when I was in California was Reiki. And Reiki is an energy healing system. So when I came back to visit Jimmy and Grace, at that time, Jimmy already was ill. And I was sitting on the floor, as many of us tended to do. It looked like we were sitting at their feet, but really it was the most comfortable place since the sofas were wet, very, very old. And I dared to suggest, Jimmy, would it be all right, would you be willing to let me do a energy healing on you? And they both said, what? And I tried to explain, and then I said, well, I really can't explain it. I just want to touch you. And Jimmy laid on the sofa and allowed me to do Reiki. And that, to me, was an incredible experience on many fronts. It was just their openness and willingness to explore and experience. And it speaks to what is essential, a willingness to be open and to allow experience, and to allow us to experience what is. I guess that's it. My mouth is dry, and it is getting late. Thank you.
Nora Davis Day, who is the daughter of Ozzie Davis and Ruby Dee, will share a few words, a few reflections on the relationship of her parents to James and Grace Boggs. And then we'll go into an episode of a television show that Ozzie and Ruby Davis used to host that James and Grace were once guests on. And you are here for the New York premiere of this television show that was taped in 1982. And we're going into that because Grace loved conversations. And this episode is the closest thing many of us in this room will get to seeing Grace in conversation. And so we'll move in right from Nora's comments into that. So I give you Nora Davis Day, please.
Good evening, everyone. As you just heard, I am one of Ossie Davis and Ruby Dee's productions, their first major co-production. And I didn't come to be particularly profound or erudite or deep. Well, that is profound, see? I came because my mom and dad loved Grace and Jim so much that there's no place else that I could be than here tonight. As you might imagine, the vocabulary of our lives, my brother, my sister, and me, was filled with names like Du Bois and Robeson and Malcolm and Betty and Angela Davis and Fannie Lou Hamer. And I have to admit, as a child around all these great minds and artists, I didn't always know. It was time for me to go to bed, so I didn't know the deep conversations that they were having over coffee or deep into the night. It was like normal and ordinary for us, but it wasn't until we looked back in the rearview mirror of our lives that we realize just how extraordinary our lives were. I met Grace and Jim Boggs when we did the television series in the 80s. I was one of the producers. I was fascinated because my parents seemed to be in love with them. They read voraciously everything they wrote. They talked at every opportunity about Grace and Jim. So it was my pleasure to be involved. I was the kid, so I didn't always sit in on all of the conversations, but I know how impressed they were. And as I was told that when Grace passed, on her bed, the head of her bed was a picture of my mother. And certainly when Mom had her last days, Conversations in Maine was one of the books not far. And I remember she was always saying, I gotta get out to see Grace. I gotta get out to see Grace. And she couldn't, but I bet they're together now. Can you imagine all that talking that's going on? So I wanted to share before we see a piece of this interview. And by the way, when I did meet her, she said, you know, people always ask me, what's the difference? They always want to know, you know, about me and Jimmy. I like my vegetables crisp. He likes his cooked to death. That's all you need to know. So I'm going to read a little bit from my father, who wrote the foreword to Living for Change, Grace's book. Life is not easy, and like most who are perpetual students, I need help. My logic limps. My conclusions stumble and fall. The truth I seek has been known to bear false witness. So when most in need of clarification, or to get confusions mended, I come to Jim and Grace to sit and listen. The fountain is always flowing. The welcome generous. They share their thinking gladly. I never leave without learning something new. This book by Grace is no exception. I read it and my cup runneth over. For here is more than a feast for the hungering heart. Here is a life stating its case in eloquent summation. The journey now in sight of the setting sun. Grace is the voice, but you'll hear Jimmy too. Caught in mid-flight, never at rest except for ammunition. Time does not stand still and neither do our two mentors. This book records two lives still up and growing. They search for truth as flowers search for sunlight, as hunters search for game, and whatever they find, they bring and put on the table. Through these pages walk causes, gatherings, confrontations, movements, and the men and women who made them, workers and students and committees of the people, Christians, Black Muslims, Black Panthers, labor unions, C.L.R. James, Reverend Clegg, Reverend Franklin, Coleman Young, Martin, Malcolm, artists, musicians, poets, actors, strikers, and seekers of revolutions, members of both their families, and Jimmy, the flaming sword, as much as Grace, his energy, his urgency, his dedication, his honesty, his patience, as well as his egregious lack of patience. And Grace, and Grace, and Grace, constant as steel, in all her moods and modes, yet supple and embracing. She takes us into the privacy of her past, filled as it is with family and books and study, with struggling like an outsider to grasp her native tongue and never quite making it, going home at last to China, but finding her ultimate citizenship in struggle, her proper setting. That's where she belongs, there in the lines of march, with all the people, growing, changing, and developing fast as the daily headlines, yet ever constant. I say it again, and therefore good for goals and for guidance, like Harriet Tubman and the North Star, journeying into the past in search of the future. This book is the pilot's log. From beginning to end, I could not read the words without hearing her voice, or seeing her face before me as she said them. Especially when she spoke of Jimmy and his dying, it was almost as if she turned and, finding the reader crying, paused until he or she caught up and then returned to talking, talking and teaching until the final page. What a life well lived. How we loved her, how we learned from her. Thank you.
If you're lucky, honestly, you know, you meet somebody every now and then that you wish everybody in the world could know.
Yeah.
Like James and Grace Boggs.
Oh, how true. Remember how we first met?
They come up.
Through a book, The American Revolution.
Pages from a Negro Worker's Notebook.
Yes, and it was so clear and
yes,
precise.
This complex economic and political structure.
And I remember,
I could understand it.
We were so excited about it. 20 books there with all the leaders we could think of.
Yeah.
Martin Luther King Jr. with, you know.
Malcolm X, President
Kennedy. Jr. Yeah. We thought that they just read this book, everything would be solved.
I see what you're saying. That business, they
might be
thought
of business. Yeah, they are thinkers really coming from Detroit. That shouldn't surprise anybody. But from that background, an industrial heartland country where they themselves work on the assembly line, it's sort of getting shaped.
Yes, and that conversation is amazing. That's another
check of this. Okay. Well, I think it's clear that nobody in the whole wide world is more dedicated to the promise and the challenge of America than a Grace and James Boggs.
What is freedom anyway, and what hurts black people is what's good for the nation. That's my position.
That you need a revolution. Is somebody who's always begging somebody else.
That's who you just got in mind.
It's at that point, I think, that you have to begin enlarging your whole perspective and making proposals, for example, for the reorganization of the country.
It's impossible for us to pick the good things out, or to pick the good things out of your whole cycle.
But what I'd like to know now is, looking backwards, how did you get to be that? I mean, you weren't born knowing all these marvelous things you tell us. You didn't come into the world able to write books like that. step by step you got from somewhere to where you are now. And I think I would love to know, and I'm sure a lot of other people would love to know. You started in Alabama, next door to me, down in Georgia. Grace, where did you come from?
Well, you know, I like to think that what I'm doing is a kind of continuation of what my parents began. My parents were Chinese immigrants. My mother was born in a small village, never went to school, never learned how to read and write until children had grown and she made some small effort to learn how to read and write. She was sold as a slave when she was a child.
Your mother?
Yes, but she ran away from the big house and she became a rebel. My
what
sister,
was
this was in a little village in China. My sister was born on the floor of steerage on the boat coming from China. My father arrived here with 50 cents in his pocket. He worked on the railroads. He started small restaurants. I was born on top of the restaurant. But he was a supporter of Sun Yat-sen, leader of the first Chinese revolution. So I like to think that what I'm doing is a continuation of what they began. Now, that may not be so many that you know, but
oh, I'm sure it is.
But you know, I think all of us are, in that sense, heirs to what our parents have bequeathed to us. So I think the most significant event in my life was when I left university in 1940. I got my doctorate just as the Franz Fell for the Nazis. And I had spent most of my life studying European civilization. And it seemed to me that Western civilization had collapsed. And so I decided to go to Chicago, you know, the city of the heart of the gist of the world, city of war shoulders and all that sort of thing. I was going to go to the heart of America. And I went there and I lived on the south side of Chicago in a basement apartment where the rats were as big as cats and where I didn't have to pay any rent. And I used to go out on the south side of Chicago, the Washington Park, you know, the park there. And I saw black people, we call them Negroes then, just sitting up underneath the trees, just vegetating. The war industry was booming, but blacks were not allowed in. And one day, A. Philip Randolph announced the first march on Washington. We call it the first march on Washington now, because there's been a second, but it wasn't called the first march on Washington then. And I remember visiting a young woman, her name was Mary, in her room. You know, we all lived in furniture rooms in those days. I think the idea of and she was ironing her clothes to go on the march. And she had changed overnight from a person who was passive and vegetating to a person who had hope because she was going to struggle for something. And I saw how grasping an advanced idea could transform a person, and how people who are engaged in that could begin to transform the world. And I decided then that was what I was going to commit my life to.
And that can be about why for me, you know, that David Marie. But you know one thing, I read Campaign Cutter. And you know, the truest thing I found out, all of we black kids down south, every John Cullen and all the folks. Now, I'm quite sure the reading they let us have that is cool. And of course, they say we black folks ain't got nothing with it, no how. So we just read all of them. I didn't know when the black people got started up here, about going back and reading all these black folks. I don't read the Cullen. Way back then. And you know, everything was cut so cutting that was someday I'd like to take a knife to cut myself loose from this ranking tie. And anyhow, one goes quarrelsome and weary as he goes into the fray. And there was something in me was just a rebel. Now, I want to make very clear, I was just a rebel. I was rebelling against everything. And then finally, then I sent my graduate from high school, my court friend, trained to come to Detroit. Now, I come based on lies. See, you remember Richard Wright and all of the
right.
It's all evil. And we learn all from lies, but I like you to know.
You look at that.
Tremendous people, our people.
first thing I saw was a soup line. Coach, you have a soup line. I had never seen a soup line in my life. But at least we had chickens and corn out there and collard greens and collard greens. And they had plenty to eat downtown. There was a different one to see when the NRA come out. You remember the National Recovery Administration Act? Downtown, he said the NRA means Negro Ragged.
When we were demanding first-class citizenship,
We were saying we were being denied that. We were very ethical, but we wanted more than that. Among ourselves and as individuals, but we wanted more than that. We wanted to become part of the people who took responsibility for the country.
Yes, I have a feeling that we didn't get it clear in our heads what we wanted.
Because we didn't get clear in our heads what we wanted, it seemed to me, we began to think that what we wanted more was the material things.
That's right.
And there is a polarity between them. Sometimes you have to make a choice. And I think you do have to make a choice. You don't want your kids to starve, obviously. And I'm not saying that people should go hungry and regularly and all that. But that's not what we were asking for in the black movement. And it seems to me, particularly when Malcolm said that you need a revolution, what he meant was you should stop begging for things. I want to stop being satisfied with people just giving you things, and I want to be getting ready to take responsibility of some kind.
Yeah.
Now, we thought of it more in terms of the Black Nation as true and so forth, but the concept of taking responsibility for the community was what really gave the momentum, it seemed to me, in that nationalism in the first stage. Not so much the separatism, but that concept of responsibility.
And I like that.
Freedom to do.
That was James Gracie Ball from the TV show Ozzy and Ruby Gates. We've come to that's the end of the program, and before we close, you will find on the let me say a few remarks and then I'll go forth. That Grace's last concept, that Grace's last points there about responsibility. There are several things that Grace said to me over the years that I hope will always stay with me. There was one that became one of the most important things anybody had ever said to me in my life. She said, Matt, you need to see yourself, because Grace and I had independently come to the same conclusion that due to its internal contradictions and due to the need for the capitalist system to exploit nature and the environment, and the fact that we live under the environmental crisis that we currently live,
simply stated, what capitalism needs to continue growing and maintain itself is simply no longer available. And so Grace and I had come to understand that crisis of the capitalist system as an opportunity to create something anew. We had come to that, and we were having a conversation about that, and Grace said to me, she smiled. At the time, I think she was 94, maybe 95, and she smiled, like only I've ever seen a 94 or 95-year-old woman smile. And she said, Matt, you need to see yourself as responsible for bringing forth a transition as significant as the transition from hunting and gathering to agriculture and from agriculture to industry. No one had ever challenged me to assume any responsibility of the sort. And I laughed uncomfortably, but I quickly began to understand that that is what it means to commit ourselves to the process of building a revolution, to assume responsibility for taking humanity to another plateau, which cannot be done under a capitalist, racist, patriarchal system, which cannot be done without changing ourselves into human beings who are willing to do the work of changing ourselves to change the world. Grace, in the early 1980s, as an internal document to NORA, wrote a paper called I Must Love the Questions Themselves. And in this paper, she had talked about all of the solutions that the movement organization she was a part of had come up with. And it seemed more or less that many of the solutions they implemented, them as well as other organizations that agitated and organized in such a way as to make those solutions reality. Every time that happened in this paper, Grace documented historically that every time one of those solutions was implemented, they gradually began to see that those solutions created more problems and crises that required more solutions. She said, there is no final struggle. Every solution we come to that's when the problems begin, because we've got a whole other set of implications to examine. And she said, so rather than coming up with answers, we must learn to love the questions themselves. And so we are asking you all tonight, before you leave, as you go down into the lobby, there is a table of Boggs, of merchandise being sold by the Boggs Center. We ask you to buy that merchandise and support the Boggs Center, because Grace was not an individual. She was only who she was in relationship to other people and to the organization she was a part. And we ask you all to contribute what you can to that organization. And we ask you to visit a brown piece of paper right behind that table and write down some of the questions that have come up for you over the course of the evening and the questions that you just care to ponder and think others should ponder generally. And we'll take a picture of that and do something with it. So we ask you please to, in an attempt to love the questions ourselves, we're asking all of us to go down and write a question on that board. There are markers down there behind you, and a good brother, Sean Lynn, I believe, is on his way down there. He's got his hand up in the back, so look for Sean and get yourself a marker. Just an announcement, on Friday, the 20th of November, the movie On Grace, American Revolutionary, will be screening at the Mayday Space in Bushwick. I don't know what the address is, but if you Google Mayday Space, you'll find it. And that'll be followed by a conversation, a series of small group conversations facilitated by Visionary Organizing Lab following the film. So I encourage you all to attend. And I thank you all once again for coming. This has been an incredible night, and I'm grateful for all the participants. I'm grateful for the contributions of Corbin in the back, who led us through the technology and who patiently struggled through the difficulties. Sean Lynn, Amaka Okechukwu, myself, and Beatrice Beckford, who were the core organizers of this memorial, and I want to acknowledge all of us. And once again, thank the Shabazz Center for donating the space, and thank you all for coming out. Thank you.